Welcome back, guys, to Tuesday Night Hype 74 for the second semifinal match between It's Proto Hype and Taft's Bathtub. So same thing here, you know, we get a little look at the classes, and it looks like both shamans are going to be banned, and Proto Hype's going to be opening with Warlock, Rogue, and Warrior taking on Taft's Bathtub's Mage, Rogue, and Warrior. What do you think, just looking at the decks here?
Taft Bathtub's Freeze Mage looks really interesting. I'd like to see that. It has a Kobold. What's the full name of that card? It's a new card.
Yeah, the Evolved Kobold, right? It's the 2/2 of +2 spell damage.
Yeah, that's interesting. That's a new card. I haven't seen that list ever. So I'm excited to see that. And we have Taft has brought a Mali Rogue, which is going to probably take on Proto's Miracle Rogue. And I know that there's a few people out there who prefer the Mali Rogue, and there's other people who prefer the Miracle Rogue. So,
which one do you think has the edge there if they do like have to face off against each other?
Mali Rogue has the late burst, but then it's like if the Miracle Rogue gets, you know, that Auctioneer, and then they get like their draws right, I think that the Miracle Rogue could probably take down the Mali Rogue faster. So it all just depends, really. I don't have enough experience with those two matching up with each other, but so it'd be fun to see what happens, really.
Yeah, I think you kind of hit it, though. You know, talking about which one gets on board first, which one gets the Auctioneer out, which one is just faster in general. Looks like the Miracle Rogue could be a little bit faster. At the same time, as you said, I'm excited to see this Kobold. And do you think it's for some sort of OTK or just unexpected reach?
I think it really is an OTK because I saw that there's Cold Light Oracles and a lot of, like, 2 Arcane Intellects. So that's, like, a lot of draw. And I think the plan is to just draw a lot of cards and then just have the Kobold ready to just burst down later at the end.
Yeah, I mean, it changes the map, and especially Proto Hype, you know, he should know what's coming. I think we saw this weekend in EU prelims, when you put interesting cards in your deck, I think George C. had Leroy Jenkins and Temple Warrior, right? So players are playing around things very differently. I think here Proto Hype might play a little bit differently, seeing that there's an Evolved Kobold in his opponent's list.
They have access to each other's lists?
These are up. So, you know, They can go ahead and like kind of see what's going to come at them. It's just pretty interesting that when you have access, you definitely play a little bit differently than you normally would. You know, you might play a little more scared of things like Harrison, and you might play around some unexpected damage.
That's true. That's pretty cool that you guys, they have access to each other's lists. So Proto also has a C'Thun Warrior, so that's also kind of different. Have we seen any C'Thun Warriors in the prelims?
Yeah, we saw a lot of C'Thun Warrior prelims. You know, actually, AK Wander brought 4 C'Thun decks and qualified out of the winners there in the top 8.
So he was the only one with the C'Thun Warrior.
I think there's a few C'Thun Warriors, but, you know, I think he's definitely the only one with 4 C'Thun lists. So that was crazy. Like C'Thun Druid, C'Thun Warlock. So it looks like we're about to get in here right now, and we're going to have Taft's Bathtub taking on Proto Hype in your second semifinal of Tuesday Night Hype.
Oh, I need to get invited.
Looks like here we're going to have Shaman versus Shaman. I think these is actually going to be a fake game right here, both these classes being banned by each other. Now, just looking back at sort of the actual matchups here, looks like we have a lot of, you know, things that are just battling each other. We have the Warrior matchup. We have Tempo Warrior could take on the C'Thun Warrior. We have the Rogue Mare. But the one difference here is Reno Warlock and then Freeze Mage. Mm-hmm. Which one there do you think might actually have the upper edge?
I like the... I think it's a 50-50, really, because it's like the Freeze Mage can take down a Reno Lock if the Reno Lock doesn't have the heals. Mm-hmm. So it all just depends. If the Reno Lock has the Reno Jackson, Siphon Soul, and things like that, in their hand, it's easy for them to just heal up when they need to. But if they don't have those cards, and the freeze mage gets their burst, they could just take them down really fast.
Yeah, you know, like losing anti-kill bot, that was super huge. But Reno is sometimes enough, so it's a very interesting sort of jostle there that's going on. And then sometimes we see in Reno some interesting choices. We've seen in the past, like the Apothecary, the Cold Apothecary. I don't think that's in Prohype's list, so it's definitely going to be an interesting battle when it comes down to those guys. I think one match I haven't seen too much of, but we did see it over EU Premiums quite a bit, was C'Thun Warrior and Tempo Mage. So there, it's very interesting battle. And C'Thun Warrior, once they get to that point, they're very hard to take down with all that armor built up.
Right, but generally the Tempo Mage, you said Tempo Mage, right?
Tempo Warrior.
Oh, Tempo Warrior. I thought I heard about it. Tempo Warrior. Yeah, the Tempo Warrior got really big after Sho played it in the High Ladder, High Legend Ladder, actually. And he released the list, and everyone's having a go at it. And I know that there are two versions of the mid-range Tempo Warrior. I don't even know what's right. Mid-range Warrior, Tempo Warrior. There's people fighting about those names. There's one version that doesn't run two monkey taunts, and then there, I think they added an extra whirlwind and an extra acolyte, something like that. And then there's the other version which does have the monkeys. So I'm not quite sure which one Taff brought. I think he has the monkeys, actually.
Yeah, and it looks like he's running the Varian list. I think there's been a tiny bit of debate about what to play in that last spot. Arc Thief or Fom has seen some play. And then some other tech cards, like Sir Finley, saw some play this weekend too. So
really?
It's interesting. It's I think it's because of Rogue. So there's a lot of things that's why George C. also brought Leroy, is to just deal more damage against Rogue, kind of race Rogue in that sense. It really helps in the matchup, though.
I know that Rafam, like you said, used to be used in the mid range warrior, but as soon as Sho took that out and put the Varian, it started reminding me of that. What's that old deck that Russian guy made before Whispers of the Old Gods?
Sodden and Dushi. Yeah.
There we go. It started becoming more like that.
And he had Karen in there before Karen return to the meta. So,
exactly.
You know, there's definitely some foresight going on there.
Foreshadowing.
It's a great deck. It's actually really fun to play. I think a lot of people compare it to Druid in the way that you kind of just play minions, and sometimes you trade, sometimes you go face, but it's very minion heavy. But also, I like just playing Varian, right? And remember how much we used to just talk about how bad Varian was, but this is finally a meta where Varian can shine.
I know, finally. And I mean, if he pulls out a Rag or he pulls out your Corcoran, or a Gromash, those are like cards that you can use already on that turn. So it's great. What else is there? Oh, and Malkarok, the new legendary, is also in the mid-range warrior. I've had the horrible experience of getting a cursed blade. Is it cursed?
Oh no, cursed blade.
It was so bad. My opponent was a druid and he had Savage Roar, and the Violet Teacher ended up doing 10 damage to my face. It was so bad.
No, it's that one. That's the weapon you do not want, but usually Malkarok works pretty well, right? Okay, so it does look like we're going to get into this first game between our second semifinal. And it looks like Taps is going to be on this mage. What? And Protohype is going to be starting off with the Rogue.
Awesome. Rogue versus Freeze Mage. I know that, I think the Freeze Mage usually wins this matchup, but I could be wrong. I mean, there's still a chance for the Miracle Rogue.
Yeah, it's really just about time. I mean, you know, Rogue can break the ice block, things like that. So not as easy anymore for Mage to win this matchup. They can't always get out the ice block with Mad Scientist. But at the same time, what can Rogue really do after Alexstrasza, right? Usually nothing.
Yeah, they don't. Their only heals are the Farseer, and they only run usually one of those. And they're taking a lot of face damage. Well, not so much against a freeze, but maybe a little bit of face damage.
Yeah, it's not as much as like when Zoo's just tapping and tapping away, right? So that they get down to 15 without Alexstrasza actually coming out. Now, looking at these hands, though, no, Taps is sort of get the Frost Novas, has Doomsayer, stuff like that for later on. No real early game draw. What is Protohype looking for, though, to kind of stick on the board here?
I really think he does want, like, his draws and maybe secrets already, but he could actually just play this turn. He could... Oh, okay, he wants to take out his Fireball. He does run 2 Forgotten Torches, so I think losing that Fireball is okay.
Yeah, there's a lot of very fast burn in this deck. I think that's sort of what we saw, you know, going back a little bit even before Old Gods. We saw Freeze Mage sort of evolve from a deck that wasn't running Forgotten Torches, but then it became a little bit faster to take advantage of some of those matchups. There's a lot of interesting things. You know, Amnesiac was one of the people that definitely started doing that.
I think Laughing HS has always been a Freeze Mage player, and he had maybe he was one of the first ones with the Forgotten Torch versions.
Yeah, it looks like we're just gonna see Edwin come down. Ooh, but we also get Conceal on the back end.
Wait, that came. Okay, that's coming up. I was thinking, what if he's playing it before to make? Oh no, that worked out. He wants to conceal after to make sure that Taft doesn't have another Fireball, I guess.
I mean, we have Doomsayer Frost Nova though, right? And
yeah.
It looks like right here, Protohype's actually going to be able to take care of that. We do have the Backstab, Evis, and the Weapon Hit. So that will be enough. Also, just getting these freezes down is super important. You know, we might even have Cold coming the turn after. So if you can just prevent Edwin from ever attacking, then you're going to be in a pretty good spot.
Oh, this is great. Protohype has the answer to this Doomsayer. So that's good. That's good for Protohype. And Taft does not have another Doomsayer with his second Frostbolt, not just yet. No draw still for Taft.
Yeah, that's could definitely hurt. You know, you have some of your stuff, you have like the Frostbolts and the Ice Lances and Alexstrasza, but you gotta start cycling, right? And especially if the rogue gets gadgets and down and able to cycle a bit faster than you, then you could start to get in some trouble.
You think Cone of Cold is coming out here? Depends how much.
I like taking out Thalnos, right?
Yeah. Take out that spell damage. His rogue really likes that spell damage, but the Protohype gets another card from killing off the Thalnos.
I'm actually my spectator, so what is that middle card there? Because on my view, it is actually turned the other way around.
Oh, which, on Protohype?
Yeah. What's the middle card right
Conceal?
There? Conceal. Okay, awesome. So Taps does pick up the Ice Block here. And this looks like it's going to start, you know, we're going to be able to coin out Alexstrasza the turn after this. We can play the Ice Block here if we want. You don't really feel like you're under any sort of pressure right now as a Freeze Mage.
I think he's going to coin the
Seeker here. No. You kind of don't have to, right? It feels like you just have a lot of time, you know?
Yeah, it's a lot of health. Maybe he's thinking about this guy's coining Alexstrasza next turn already.
Do you think we can do it, you know, before? Do you ever think that, there's the Fireball. So now we do have enough burn to be able to make a play like that. That would be, So that would be enough burn, you know, just from hand. So what do you think about just being a little aggressive and playing Alex right here?
Yeah. Because he could take, Taft's Bathtub could definitely take down Protohype the next turn. So let's calculate that.
I mean, it's not enough. It's just not going to be enough from the hand of Protohype right here. You don't have that burst that you normally do have, as, you know, sometimes Rogue doesn't draw into all of their burst. And at 24 on turn 8, that's where Freeze Mage is going to be do just fine, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, Proto has the hype. Sorry, Proto hype has the sap here, so Alex is not gonna go face, and that doesn't. That means no lethal yet.
Well, that burn's gonna go face, right? So the burn's gonna hit. I mean, you know, the firebolt, frostbolt, and the ice lances are going to be enough, actually, for the freeze mage in this first match. So I think that's kind of what we expected going into the match, that if freeze mage isn't pressured, if the rogue doesn't do enough to really put the pressure on and break the ice block, things like that, then it's just very difficult for the rogue to actually do much against freeze mage.
Hold up here. Proto could actually kill Taff next turn unless Taff puts ice block down.
Taff, well, he just has enough damage right here. Yeah, that's just going to be enough. With the double enough. Ice lance.
Oh,
yeah.
I see.
Yeah, it was tied in a little bit in the back of the hand, but he kind of planned it right there, you know? Once you had the two turn lethal.
Oh, damn. Okay, that's it.
So Taff's going to take the first match with the Freeze Mage. Getting that win against the Protohype's Rogue, I kind of think that, you know, that's expected. Unlucky for Protohype to sort of cue into that first matchup. But what do you think going up here next with these two remaining classes? You know, we have Rogue and Warrior. Where's that rogue really looking to get that win?
Mid-range warrior. I think it could do okay against the C'Thun warrior. I think it's a 50-50 match. I think it's also okay against the Reno lock. It's actually pretty... Mid-range warrior, I think, is slightly favored against the Miracle Rogue. I did some tests against these two classes, and the mid-range warrior came out on top.
It's pretty close, right? I think it really, does it come down to sort of like armor smiths and things like that?
It just has a lot of, it can fill the board, and Miracle Rogue doesn't have like, maybe not enough spells to deal with all, like taking down all these minions.
Yeah, and, one thing about Rogue, you know, we're not even scared about Blade Flurry anymore, right? So
yeah, exactly. Just like put all your minions out, go.
As long as they have more than one health, you're usually kind of all right. Usually kind of fine.
Yeah, and plus Warrior has weapons, you know, so it helps a lot. They're still deciding what to pick right now, but it's crazy that they both banned the aggro shaman on each other's ends.
Yeah, I think for Tafts makes a lot of sense, you know, because Freeze Mage, also running Rogue too, so that's a very tough matchup. I think you just want to play Rogue, right? And Aggro Shaman, that's the one deck keeping Rogue in check at the moment.
Okay, let's see if the mid-range Warrior beats the Miracle Rogue here.
Yeah, so in your test, so you're seeing sort of, is it just that Warrior is going to get down a lot more minions and be able to kind of race the Rogue? Or what's really happening in this matchup?
Because usually the Rogue doesn't really do anything. Oh, and look, the Rogue didn't start off with the coins. So the Protohype may just play a SI just on turn 3 for its body. And that's the only threat for now. I think he's going to save his backstab with Teacher on turn 4. Or, no, actually, he could backstab. Yeah, he can combo the backstab with the SI on turn 3. Coin out the turn 3 for... Since he's got so many... There's so many 3 drops in a mid-range warrior.
Oh, yeah, I think you have Black, 4, Frosty, right? Monkey. And the Ravaging Goal, too. This guy's so usually doesn't come out on 3, but it. So there, yeah, Protohype really able to take advantage of the backstab. I think it's just gonna be one of those things. You know, Taz probably still needs weapons and ways
to
like fire
reward. I was about to say, if he had axe,
yeah,
that would have been great. But he doesn't. So, but there's still nothing that Protohype can't kill this frothing just yet. Pay attention. Oh no, he can. He can hit it. He'd hit it first. Oh no, hit it last. Yeah. He wants to keep his agent alive.
Some of these tempo warrior lists, I think some of them are running brawls as well, right?
Really? I actually thought about putting a brawl in mine to be different, but I didn't think that anyone else did it yet.
I've seen some tech on ladder, things like that, so I don't think, I'm not sure about task list. We'll have to take another look. But right here, definitely faced with an interesting turn. You know, you don't really, Bloodhoof, you're not too sure about just based on what you're seeing from the enemy minions. But what other sort of plays do you have right here? I mean, you can play Ravaging Ghoul, but you're only taking out 3-1. You might want to save it for more violent feature.
You save Ghoul. I was thinking the Bloodhoof taunt to just, like, weaken some stuff. And if Protohype makes more, you know, tokens, the Ravaging Ghoul will come down later, maybe with Acolyte. So, yeah, he goes with the taunt first to sort of, since he doesn't have weapon, he's going to try and hope that his taunt weakens the minions of the teacher, especially. But, okay, the sap's going to come out.
Yeah, this just seems like a great sap. Just get the Bloodhoof Brave out of the way. And you can, yeah, I think on the back here, Protohype going to drop Edwin and just play as a 4-4. It's really nice. Just continue to put pressure on this warrior.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no. And he doesn't even have, Taft doesn't even have his execute. So if the ghoul came down here with an execute, that would have been great. But he doesn't have that. He might look for it. No. What is the best option here for Taft?
I mean, Ravaging Ghoul seems okay, and you can take out two minions, but the question really is, what else are you doing on this turn?
Mm-hmm. I think he might be going for a slam and then Ghoul, but he can't kill two of the minions if he does that option.
This is another play. I kind of like this play a little bit, you know, a little bit more aggressive, but getting the Bloodhoof Brave pumped up, able to use the Whirlwind to take out the 3-1 and the 1-1. And both these minions by themselves can't do anything against this, you know, normally. So you're just going to have to make some tough decisions here for Protohype.
I like that play a lot, actually. Well, the teacher still lives. Blood to Icar.
It's just another tough turn, isn't it?
He might even just Acolyte Blood to Icar and, like, draw something.
You could do something like Slam, Ravaging Ghoul, Blood to Icar. Like, Blood to Icar, Slam, Ravaging Ghoul, and take out the teacher? No. Trying to think.
It's either that or he wants draw, but he's close to, he's like 20 HP.
Yeah, okay, so it does look, this might be like the play. Okay, yeah. So gonna use the Blood to Icar to generate the 2-2, play the Ravaging Ghoul. No one likes keeping a violent teacher on board, and I think definitely pretty smart to get rid of it as soon as possible. But again, though, you know, those can't really drop the gadgets in just yet. You're probably waiting a little bit, but at the same time, you're creating sort of board control, and you can do it again here at ERF as well.
Yeah, I think, okay, he's not going to go for the Auctioneer. There's no spells that he can use with it, but yeah, just having the body up, I guess, is fine. I mean, Protohype should know that Taft doesn't even have his execute or his weapon. It feels so bad for the warrior right now.
If you really wanted to play the Auctioneer, you could, and then you could run the 5-3 to 3-3, get the coin. And then just like Eva's face if you really, really wanted to play it, right? And get two draws off of that. It'd be interesting. Right, I like this play, though. I like playing Earth in the Rain, and then you're able to heal up, you know, the body there and actually continue to just control the board.
Well, that's great. Yeah, because if he played Auctioneer, he'd have to sacrifice the 5-4 into that, most likely. There's the axe. Late.
Little late. Yeah, little late.
I think it's the blood hoof here in the axe. Axe on turn 7.
I mean, I guess it is better than nothing, but definitely that was something I think we needed when we saw SI7 agent, right? We needed it then. Here, unfortunately, Bloodhoof's going to be able to take care of pretty easily, too. If he wants to take the 5 damage, that is.
He did get Arathi either. Arathi gives you a weapon, a 2/2 weapon. Does he run Arathi? Most of them do.
Yeah, a lot of them. Some of them run one. Some of them run two. So it's kind of depending on what you're really making room for there. Gonna go ahead and give the Tomb Pillager stealth there with the toxin applied by Zeril. And right here, look, the warrior. Ooh, okay.
He has to rag and just
we're
hit the
We're going for it, right? We're just going for it.
Yeah. He has to.
Big 50-50 coming up here. I mean, hey, put your faith in Ragnaros, and we shall see what it's going to do. And for Taps, it's going to hit the mini with stealth, so huge turnaround there. Protohythe, though, is about to draw a ton of cards.
Yeah. Coin. What's that? What's that spell? Blood Thistle Toxin. Turn a tiny mini to your hand. That's probably the worst one, huh? Is that the worst toxin you can get from Zeril?
There's a couple. Yeah, it's definitely not good to stealth. I mean, you can still use it with Leeroy, though, right? So sometimes in this deck, it does actually apply in that sense.
Grommash.
It's a tough choice, though.
Yeah, because he doesn't know. Taff doesn't know what Protohype has in his hand, and he's thinking, if he has Leeroy, I'm just dead. But if he doesn't, there's a chance.
At the same time, I think, you know, you couldn't just play Armorsmith and Hero Power there. You had to sort of do it. And now Protohype's going to be looking for damage, and he finds damage. Leeroy Jenkins off the top. That's going to be enough right there. So Protohype can tie the series at 1-1 with this Miracle Rogue. It was a pretty interesting matchup there. We just saw the Rogue get on board first and never really let go.
Yeah, so the Rogue actually won that. But, did you see that the warrior caught up sort of at the end, even though he didn't have the axe, he didn't have any executes. It's like his rag had to get lucky to snipe that minion at the end, and there was a chance for him to take the game, but the Miracle Rogue did get Leeroy.
I mean, that deck just has a lot of bursts that you normally wouldn't expect, right? I think there's sometimes I'm playing it and Frobbing all of a sudden becomes absolutely huge because there's multiple whirlwinds in the deck. So you kind of have to be a little careful what type of word there. You know, fortunately, Protohype was able to just get the burst that he needed immediately and end it before Temple Warrior sort of eats back into the match right there.
So that's a win for Proto's Miracle Rogue. So it's 1-1.
And this is going to be Rogue against Warrior again. This time, Taps is going to be running the Rogue. Tapsless, as we know, is actually going to be a Malagos Rogue, so a little bit different. But Protohype's Warrior is going to be C'Thun Warrior. So what do you think about, you know, this matchup compared to the other one?
Oh, I think this is harder for... Oh, but since it's a Mali Rogue, they could do a lot of damage. I've seen somebody Shadow Strike the face... Mm-hmm. And then Shiv, and then Sinister Strike. That did about, I think 28 or 29 damage, and it was crazy.
I think when people were looking, reviewing cards, no one thought about Shadow Strike being able to hit the face, right?
Yeah, against Warrior with a lot of armor, you can do that. And I think I saw somebody even heal the Warrior's face for 2. So he could, with the Farseer, so he could take down all that damage with the Shadow Strike.
That's kind of ridiculous. Now, Protohype here on turn 3, you know, you have the opportunity, you could coin out Bran, and that's sort of, it's a bold play, but then you're sort of making the Rogue really react to this. Taps does, though, have an answer here. I mean, I think you kind of just go ahead and Sinister Strike this, right?
You mean Shadow Strike?
Yeah, Shadow Strike.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I mean, would there be an opportunity where you might save it for that late game burst, or do you think Bran's just too big of a threat?
I think he was really thinking about prep there. Like, he could have done many things there. He could have prepped Fan, and then Shadow Strike. He could have prepped Shadow Strike and then played Agent. But then I think just the Shadow Strike alone was best there for Taff.
This guy's toast.
Now he's gonna check the axe.
Gonna see SI7 Agent just come on down here. Now, it looks early on that Cthulhu Warrior's not putting all too much pressure on. Does the Rogue have the ability, though, to deal a ton of enough damage? Or does Cthulhu Warrior sort of just get out of reach?
I think the Rogue can deal enough damage, but if Protohype just uses the Shield Maiden, it's going to be really hard.
It is Malgus, so, you know, it's going to be like a ton of damage that could come from the hand here. Protohype's starting to build all these C'Thun cards, though. And, you know, Ancient Shieldbearer coming down. It's going to be able to gain 10 armor on turn 7, things like that. And as long as C'Thun is built up turn after turn, it's going to be pretty important.
He might backstab here. Wait, let's see. As soon as he puts 3 minions on the board, it's going to be a brawl, though. Brawl's going to come.
Backstab for 4 is not bad, though, right?
That's great. Yeah, it's nice. But he has to trade in with his Drake if he wants any of his minions to live. But he could. He might just sacrifice. Okay, no, he doesn't. If he sacrifices 3-3 and then the brawl came up, at least you know that a Drake is going to live.
Yeah, he could have made a decision also, you know, not tempt, sort of like play around it as well.
It's really different, right, when you see people's hands, because then you're just, like us, being casters, we can see the hands, and we're like, oh, we know what's coming, but sometimes you have to really put your mind and be the player, and you can't always predict what's in your opponent's hand.
Yeah, a few options here, but it looks like Disciple C'Thun is going to be able to take out the Drake. I really like that. You're building your C'Thun up too for the next turn. You know, C'Thun's 14 now, so activates the Ancient Shieldbearer. C'Thun's also in hand for those of you that haven't glanced at it just yet. So it's going to be able to come down and wreak some havoc on turn 10 as well.
That is 6-6 right now. And he can't use Shieldbearer yet. I actually thought this was called a Shield Maiden. It's a Shieldbearer. Shieldbearer can't. It's not going to activate the 10 armor yet, because it's not a 10 attack.
No, I think that's actually just a spectator bug.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think it's just like sitting in hand as a 6-6. But if we look at how it's been, it's actually a 14-14 right here. So double brawl, though, coming to the hand as well. You're not going to get much better than 3 minions on the board of a rogue, right?
Right, but okay. Damn, it really is a bug then. Okay, yeah, it's a 14-14. He doesn't want to sap that.
No, definitely doesn't want to sap that. You have an opportunity to backstab an SI. That's not too bad. You know, you're definitely playing in. I think I would definitely expect a brawl to come after that. But this seems pretty efficient to be able to clean this up and then, you know, keep hitting face.
Oh no, the brawl is definitely coming out now. It's 4 minions. That's really great. You know, when a Miracle Rogue puts down 4 minions.
Well, that means you're in trouble, right? Like.
You got a brawl. That's a sweet brawl.
Yeah, there's another one to back it up coming up on the later turns if they choose. And Protohype also picking up Harrison. So going to be able to fetch through this deck a little bit more as well. Even on the back of this brawl, you can even play a shield block.
Oh no, Taft has all spells in his hand and no minions. I hate it when that happens as a rogue. Like, you need to put minions to at least pressure. Because, like, he wants to save Sinister Strike for, you know, the Malagus. And he might have to shiv to... Oh, there we go.
That, That's a card.
Yeah, there's the minion, and it happens to be the auctioneer. And he's going to Shiv here. Cycle. Okay.
Ooh, and picks up the deadly poison. That's going to be pretty huge, you know, and the prep as well. So how deep do you think we're going to go here? Just the deadly poison, or maybe even try to prep something out?
He's saving the prep. Good that, I'm glad that he used his weapon, because the Harrison would have just taken that down.
And Prolapse in, all of a sudden, in kind of a tough spot, right? What are you, you know, you can't directly deal with the gadgets, and you could brawl and take that 50-50. I don't think that's, you know, something you're really looking to do. What else? I guess we could draw here, look for something else, like a shield slam, something like that.
He's gonna see what he gets first, because he could still, okay, he's gonna go for the brawl. Because the auctioneer is just too valuable.
It's scary. It's definitely scary. Yeah, so this is another huge 50-50 with the brawl. Gaston is going to die. So, Tabs.
He's going to die.
That was huge. Like, Tabs had that opportunity to sort of start cycling through the deck, really picking up. And it's talked about just a bunch of spells in hand. What else are you going to do at this point?
Well, now that both brawls are gone, Taff now knows that he can just drop all his minions and they'll be okay. Unless he has executes, of course.
And it looks like we could see Cthulhu, we could also see Emperor. There's a few options here. It looks like Cthulhu's gonna come down doing 14 damage. He definitely wants us to hit some of the minions.
Oh, it killed the Edwin.
It only killed one though, right? So Taff's all of a sudden pretty close in terms of damage, just needs to draw into something else. We're very, very close, though.
He might prep Fan of Knives, or he just might Fan of Knives. Not sure if he's going to prep it. But he needs to draw something. You don't want to tap that, do you?
No, you definitely...
So bad.
You might have to, though, right?
At his hand, I mean, what else can you do? It's so bad.
There's the Evis, and that's enough, I think. Yep, that's going to be 10 from the hand, 6 on the board, and 1 from the hero. So definitely more than enough. Hey, that's all you needed. And it looks pretty grim there for Tafts at certain times, you know, with those brawls that were able to really change the field. But Protohype just not able to finally stabilize at any point in that match.
Yeah, he did have the 2 Sinister Strikes, and the Eviscerate coming out when he drew, it was really great.
So wow. It looks like Taps is going to go up 2-1, getting that one with the Rogue. All that's left is that Temple Warrior. So where do you think it's really going to find that win? We talked about Cthulhu Warrior, Temple Warrior. Temple Warrior can kind of be a little bit too fast for Cthulhu sometimes. Also against Reno. That's not the matchup I've seen too much, but what do you think about that one?
I think the mid-range Warrior of Taff could actually... It could win against the Cthulhu Warrior. It could win against the Reno Lock. It's like I feel like all those matches would be like 50-50 really. Mm-hmm. So it's gonna be exciting to see how that turns out and how they start out.
Yeah, a lot of 4 health minions. You know, so things like Hellfire aren't doing as much work as they normally would. Stuff like that. So a little bit harder for the Warlock to really get efficient board clears against this Temple Warrior. Like, Bloodhoof Brave, that's just a very difficult card for Warlock to deal with. You know?
Yeah.
It just has too much health.
But if the mid-range Warrior of Taft, if he builds a board and then he, Twisting Nethers, that's gonna be brutal. Or if he heals himself with Reno and Taft has a board, it's still okay. But the Twisting Nether, I think that's, the only thing that could actually hurt the mid-range Warrior.
So you see Protohype actually has Reno in hand to start. Is that something you think you'd keep in this matchup? Or you're really kind of only keeping that against, you know, some of the more aggressive decks?
You could, we're talking about Tass Mulligan?
No, Protohype. He has the opportunity to keep Reno in hand right now.
I don't think he should. I think he needs needs early cards to take on some of. I mean, he needs, like, I think. What does he run? Does he run Imp Gang and stuff like that? I think Imp Gang would be nice. Oh, I like the Ooze. Definitely keep the Ooze. He could keep the Mountain Giant. But I didn't think he would keep Reno. But yeah, with Taft, he wanted to hard mulligan for the axe. So this time he got the axe.
That's like what you're looking for, finally getting the axe. It's pretty interesting to see how people have been using it too. In this deck, a lot of times you will just equip it and not attack. I think it might change a little bit because people are using Harrison left and right as well.
Yeah, so you only want to put the axe out when you can actually use it. Because I'm sure he knows that Protohype has an ooze. Yeah, this is normally the case. You just tap until you have enough options. Or he's gonna... Protohype's gonna put down the Mountain Giant soon.
Yeah, you can next turn just play Mountain Giant. Also have some more defensive options as well. I mean, turn 4 Mountain Giant is nothing to scoff at, though. Looking here at Taft's hand, some interesting things we could do here on this turn. I kind of like this. Yeah, playing the Ravaging Ghoul, gaining 1 armor, just getting the 3/3 body on the field right there, and also going to be able to activate Battle Rage on that minion as well for later.
Yeah, I like that. He needs to just put some bodies on his board. If the Mountain Giant comes down here, Taft's gonna have to slam it. Try to look for a...
I wonder.
Execute. Because he's only got... He can only deal... 7.
He could slam and... axe as well if you really want to take it. But what do you think? Yeah, I mean, you might just have to, right?
He just has to see what he draws. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, at this point in the match it's like, okay, I can take 8 damage. I'm not too worried about my life total. I do have armor smith, and honestly you get to take damage, so you're activating battle rage for your own face as well.
Yeah, that's true. Turn 5 for Proto. Oh, Doomsayer.
I mean, I like it. You didn't see execute the turn before. But the slam is a huge pickup here. You can use slam in conjunction with Blood to Ichor and the axe to actually take out the Doomsayer if you want to do that.
Yeah, I'm not sure if he's going to pick it out or just draw here and that's it. Does he really mind to loot? I mean, he might just let it kill his armorsmith, but then that would mean Protohype would take the lead,
Okay, instead of using Blood Acre, going to opt to actually use the Ravaging Ghoul. I kind of like this because you get to just stay on the board, stay aggressive in this matchup. And you're really just putting, pressure onto the Reno Warlock here, and you need to see if they can really deal with that.
At least he got to use his weapon without it being oozed both times. That's good.
Freshman Vander going to come down here. Provide the Reno Warlock with a little bit more health than, Okay, so... We have some of those later game drops. We have Malkorok, we have Ragnaros.
Ooh,
and Grom.
Coin the Malkorok.
I like coining Malkorok. Like, for sure. Gladiator's Lombo. What are we looking for here?
At least a 3-something.
Okay. So he's going to get the Rallying Blade.
That's great. That's a good weapon.
That card, I really like that card. You can play in that Divine Shield Paladin. It's definitely a ton of fun. And sometimes you get, +4/+4 on the board with it.
What can Proto do here? Do you think he's probably thinking about, does he ooze this weapon?
Well, you have to think about, you know, these tempo warriors, they normally, I guess, what else, you'd probably ooze an axe, or then you would ooze, you know, one of the things from a Rapid Weaponsmith. So it seems like a pretty good weapon to actually get rid of right now, right?
He had the option to Demon Wrath and trade his 3-5 into the Malkorok and Elven Archer down the ghoul, but I like this option too.
And it might be time for a huge battle rage, right? You know, we could do some shenanigans here. You could use Blood to Ichor, Whirlwind, draw 4 cards. What do you think about that, boy?
I think the war card's better, definitely. Oh, he's like, which minion do I kill? At least one of those. Wait, I think he should trade into... Oh, that's fine. He'll battle rage, and then he'll trade into the... Okay, well, he might go face. Do you think he'll go face, or he trade into the 3-4? Yeah. Go face, 4-6.
Looking at your hand, you know, you have Rag and Grom, so yeah, going face there, totally, you know, a little bit more aggressive, but at the same time, your board would just be weak to so many clears when you only have one health.
Yeah, Demon Wrath. Right?
Here we're just going to see Abusive actually used defensively instead of for the combo here, but Elven Archer going to get a lot of value here, taking out the 2-1, and Emperor's going to be able to come down as well. So all of a sudden, Reno Warlock has full control of this match.
Oh boy. And he has nothing to kill the Thoris, and the Thoris is going to get crazy value.
I mean, you have Ragnaros, right?
The Rag's not. Yeah, it's like, the Rag's gonna probably just snipe a smaller minion. I was thinking maybe Cairn and Fiery Axe.
No, yeah, it definitely seems good. You can take out the 3-3 there as well, clean it up a little bit.
Yeah.
I mean, 2 ticks, though. This is perhaps gonna get 2 ticks from Emperor, and that's not something to, like, you know, you can't mess around with that, right?
If Prototype were to Siphon Soul this, does the Death Rattle come out of Bloodhoof? It does, right?
If he Siphon Souls it, yeah.
Yeah, it comes out still.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes there's just really weird bugs with Hearthstone that you have to learn.
There's definitely a few. You have an opportunity to even keep up Emperor, but then you're spending a ton of resources just on Cairn. So it's kind of an interesting, you know, what you want to do here. Ooh, gets the PO here.
And scared of his life?
I don't even think that's just being fearful. I think he's just putting on pressure, right?
Yeah, exactly, because they know that Proto knows that they don't run Brawl. But he could have actually, if he had Grom and a way to activate it, right? So Proto Hype was sort of playing around that.
You might just have to take 5 damage here, right? You might just have to take the 5 from Emperor. What other ways do you sort of see to clean this up? Yeah, see, this is kind of, I think, what Protohype was thinking. Able to sort of put on pressure. It wasn't really a good way to take out Emperor. Unfortunately, the taunts are just going to come up and kind of prevent the aggression, though.
Yeah, I think that Emperor Thorison really just gave Proto the chance to put a lot of board pressure with all his cheap minions. So having it up for 2 turns cheapened his hand very nicely.
Now, what do you think about going to this turn right here? There's a lot of options, but none that are really, you know, immediately popping out.
You know, if he had a Whirlwind effect or even a Ghoul, this would have been great. Like, he could clear everything, but he doesn't have that.
I think Protohype might
have to... Are we talking about Proto's turn? Sorry, I was talking about Taft's. Proto's just Yeah, has it in the bag right now. That's, I guess that's why I was looking at Taff.
Yeah, we also got
How can Taff win this?
And Sylvanas and it, what, a 2-mana Shadow Flame, so you could have even done something like that if you really wanted to and just clear the board. Ragnaros is going to come down, do some work, get rid of that second Cairn body right there.
I think he should draw first for tapped. He can hit the Echo into the 1-1.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to just think of, I mean, you could draw Bragg, try to start doing some stuff. It's definitely a little bit of a desperation move though, right?
Yeah, he could take down the Rag actually with the Grom and the Ichor, but I don't know if he wants that. I think he's going to Rag. He wants to. Yeah. It looks like he wants to Rag.
I think it's time to Rag. I really do. And all right, Ragnaros needs to hit Ragnaros here, deal enough damage.
That's
gonna
okay.
Take. Okay, so he's not dead just yet, but. Actually, looking at this, Sylvanas Shadow Flame is going to end the game. If I assume Protohype sees that play
oh
right there.
Oh my god. That's really good. Two rags. Yeah, that is the win. That's what he... Oh, he doesn't see it. Or is it already?
I there might just be enough on board here anyway. Yeah, you can still use the Shadow Flame and kill... I would have liked to see the more style though, you know, just play the Sylvanas Shadow Flame.
Yeah,
there's
two
ways
to do that. I guess that's the other one. So it's like if you see a way for lethal, there's no point to try and think of another way to, you know.
And kill you're not hiding Sylvanas right there. You know, we've both seen your list, so like no reason there. Okay, but Protohype's gonna tie it up 2-2. Looks like we're gonna go to game 5 here. It's going to be Warrior v. Warrior. Probably on that C'Thun Warrior.
Yeah.
And Tempo Warrior coming from Tafts. It's going to be an interesting one.
Yeah. God, so far the mid-range Warrior is struggling. Bring it
on. Yeah, it just hasn't really gotten on board very well, right? Even in that last match, I mean, Tafts was able to sort of drop the ghouls, but that was all the pressure that was coming from him.
Yeah, it was really because of that Emperor Thoris and... Like, he couldn't deal with it for 2 whole turns. It's really bad.
And hey, when you want Fiery Warrocks, you might as well draw 2. Protohype starting with both in hand. So, gonna be able to deal with all those early threats coming from Tafts.
Definitely.
You're just gonna need to be able to draw a lot of cards. You know, double Acolyte. So, it's gonna be an interesting sort of race here to see how fast Tafts can play versus how much armor Protohype's gonna be able to, you know, accumulate.
He's gonna Echo here. Acolyte. Because he knows he's up against the C'Thun Warrior and he wants as much draw as he can.
I think we've seen in this matchup in particular, one of the cards that can do a lot of damage is actually Varian. But you really have to time, you'd have to play it and just hope that it doesn't get brawled, or you'd really have to just wait till second brawl. But, you know, we normally won't see the C'Thun Warrior play that second brawl until we see Varian.
Right. Yeah, so Proto is going to just hold on to his brawls here until Taft has built a huge board. Yeah, Taft... Any minion Taft put out that turn would have just been killed by the axe.
I mean,
and Proto has another axe.
He has another axe, and he has 2 shield slams and execute. So there's a lot of removal in Proto's hand right now.
He might slam into some minions. He might, but... No. Okay. Or he could have just slammed his own Echo. No, he'll play Echo and Ghoul on the same turn, turn 6.
Do you think Frobin's a minion? We might just shield slam?
No. It's too valuable. It was an option. I'm just trying to think of options, but not the best option to slam your frothing.
Yeah, shield slam gonna come down. I like this. You have a lot of removal still left. You can kind of, you know, yes, it's expensive just to take out the Frogman Berserker, but at the same time, able to sort of put your Alkali on the board, keep drawing cards. You know that you have bigger threats already in your hand that are going to come out later, too.
Here's Monkey Echo. What it would be. Yeah, because you can't ghoul right now because of the other Acolyte on the board.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, how big is the C'Thun? He hasn't used any C'Thun cards, right? Early C'Thun cards.
No, no C'Thun cards so far. Oh, not even going to get Twin Emperor. And usually, you know, by turn 7, Twin Emperor's, I think, like 80% of the time, usually good. Here, it's going to be interesting. Bad. Yeah.
This could be bad for Proto, then. Since he didn't like buff up his C'Thun and he can't use Bear yet, he can't use Veglur. And those are the cards he only has. So
There's an interesting play here, sort of with Shield Slam. At the same time you've already used the other one, so I doubt you want to just get rid of them both immediately like that. I'm trying to see like what else you do. You might just have to give your opponent even, you know, a charge from the ghoul here.
He doesn't want to make half draw, but he has to.
Mm-hmm.
Because he really wants to find his early C'Thun cards. There's his, he's gonna, he got his Disciple of C'Thun at least.
Yeah, you know, able to sort of just establish some board, cycle a little bit more. I think as Protohype cycles, it's going to be very important, especially, you know, you definitely need to hit some of those later game things. You're going to need your Brawls later, so you're going to have to cycle through your deck, even if it means giving your opponent more cycle as well.
Now Taft is faced with the same decision, like, oh, I can't draw yet, because I'm going to just make my opponent draw too.
And it looks like Taps is gonna go phase. Doesn't really want to give it up just yet. It's so interesting though the way that they're sort of going about this. Who do you think, you know, who wants to draw first? Who wants to? No one wants to overdraw, right?
Yeah, I guess Proto really had to draw. He was really desperate for his early C'Thun because the other one, his late C'Thun cards won't have the effect otherwise. Taft doesn't have any late game minions. He's got two executes, which he can't use his executes yet because Proto's not gonna put his big minions down without the C'Thun buffs.
And there we go, C'Thun is already gonna be buffed up to 10, so that's gonna make these future turns a little bit easier. You know, activating the 2/7 drops right there. Looks like Taft, you know, could keep drawing. Slam's pretty good here too as well.
Yeah, this is really good. He could trade and hit with his weapon and just drop Karen.
And Karen's one of those cards that's actually very difficult for Warrior to deal with, right?
Yeah, because Brawl's not good enough. The only thing that's good against it is Sylvanas. Because it could just kill it.
Veglur seems pretty good. 2/4/6 taunts for 7 mana. It's not bad
there
at all.
once
you get C'Thun activated, very. Oh, and there's Varian. And we see Proto has not yet drawn the Brawl. So we might see Varian kind of come down next turn and see what can happen. If we get a full board, that's how I think Taft could actually pull this match out.
He could execute both of them, but I don't think he wants to. He wants to slam and then trade his Karen. He might just execute one of them.
Oh, it's actually, you know, able to get the War Axe too. Get the War Axe out, kill one of the Emperors, just use the one execute. Mm-hmm. I really like that. And, you know, continue to just pressure with Karen here.
I like that too. Varian Rin's probably going to pull out Rag.
Or both.
Yeah. But then, does Proto have his Brawl? Nope. No Brawl for Proto.
I think it's another question. When do you use Harrison against this deck? You know, you're really looking to get value from Harrison. But at the same time, you kind of know that they don't run a ton of weapons.
I like the Harrison, yeah. Or it was either Harrison or the shield bearer.
That belongs in a museum.
Harrison gonna come down here. Interesting pickup. The fall up here is a bit weird though. You know? Yeah, you could shield block Arcosaurus armor up. Gonna go ahead and use the shield block there. C'Thun is now in the hand though, so get ready for, you know, Varian and then C'Thun probably right on the back of it.
Could be preparing for a brawl, that's why he executed that. Or so that if he trades into the Harrison, at least the death rattle's gone.
Ooh, I think it's an interesting thing for Tafs though, because you haven't seen Brawl yet, and your opponent's drawn through half their deck, right?
Yeah. He may just fill out his board here, mm-hmm. not with Varian, but like with Monkey and the Taunt to try and lure out the Brawl first.
Yeah, and you can kind of start, yeah, so playing a little bit more conservatively, just going to push, only going to keep three minions on the board. Definitely playing around Brawl.
Mm-hmm.
Is this, is this C'Thun's moment? I mean, it's not too big just yet, right?
What is it at? My game is still bugged. It still says 6-6. I know it's above 10, because he got the Vanguard.
I think it's actually right at 10.
It's 10.
So it might be a little early for that. You could also just drop Jessicar, you know, armor up twice as well. You have the coin if you do want to get the Shield Slam out there too. I think there's like, yeah, there's a few interesting plays here, right?
He might, okay. He could have even used Score Hell too.
But yeah, gonna get dropped just the card though. Get some armor, go back up to 20.
Yeah,
I think
this is a safer play.
Yeah, you gotta be thinking, okay, when can I really take this chance? But it's a very hard decision to make. It's very hard to really commit to playing Varian on this sort of board, but Varian's gonna come down here. Let's see what it pulls. Vile Rage, Arathi Weaponsmith, and Throbbing. Okay, so
okay.
Nothing amazing, but still gonna build up quite a little bit board here, and Throbbing's gonna be able to pump up just a little bit too.
It's okay. So still no Brawl. I think he's going to take down the Frothing with his Harrison here.
Yeah, you even have the Gore Howl. Kind of fits perfectly into the 7-7 right there. I guess it kind of just matters how afraid you are. You know, you could just play some other stuff. You could do like Shield Slam and play the 7 drop, gain 10 more armor.
Yeah, the Harrison could hit the Berserker. He could Gore Howl down the Varian Wrynn and Disciple C'Thun the Bloodhoof. That should be okay. Or is he thinking about C'Thuning here? No, I don't know if that's good yet.
Yeah, you haven't seen Grom yet, so you probably just want to make sure you're completely out of Grom range.
Mm-hmm.
So you might play a little bit more conservative. You might, you know, try to just gain 10 armor for now. You could still Shield Slam down the Varian.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, that too.
If you really want to go that route.
Yeah. Safer. And he can still play his Disciple. Yeah.
Yeah, this is pretty nice right here. Gets the C'Thun built up just a little bit. Because at a 10-10, I mean, still a good card, right? But it's not doing as much as it could. And you get to sort of trade off board, bring back C'Thun a little bit.
And build the C'Thun even more.
Yeah, it's a 14-14 now. And there's Grom. So definitely kind of heads up playing around that potential Grom damage. You know, there's a lot of ways to activate it. I mean, Blood to Ichor, we have some other stuff as well.
Nice draw. So
yeah, you can like double Ichor here if you want, or just play one for the body. Also with the armor sip. So all of a sudden Warrior, Tempo Warrior here actually built up, kind of took back the board. This would be a board that C'Thun could do a lot of damage on though.
Yeah, that's true. But he'll gain a lot of like a couple of armor. So maybe he'd want to take out the armorsmith first before doing that. Oh, there.
Yeah, you get a pretty good trade with the armor smith right here with the 4-2 and the gore howl. So, you know, you're never like forced to play C'Thun. I think as viewers though, we're always just like, oh, let's see C'Thun drop. You know, like let's see it come out. We want to see C'Thun, right?
A lot of people like watching Yogg get dropped.
Yeah, oh, that one's like definitely a little bit more crazy. Okay, so gets the true silver from the Malkorok here.
He might just blood to Ichor, but that's if he just really wants it.
I think you might save that for the Grom, just as the activator.
So the execute. Oh, for the Grom, yeah, or for an execute. No, well, he might ghoul and execute. I guess he'll just leave it up, the 4-1. That's fine.
Alright, what do you think here? Is now the time? Is now the time?
He could hit the... Oh no, he doesn't want to... He could trade the C'Thun's Chosen into the Malkorok first, then drop the C'Thun.
At the same time, you haven't seen any executes, right? So you might be playing sort of around that as well.
Uh-oh. Health though. Okay, he's gonna go with the shield.
Yeah,
that's why.
Well, let's gain 14 more armor. We can gain another 14 armor
that's
next
crazy.
Turn.
That's crazy. That's a lot of armor.
And you know, we have to at this point in the match, we really have to start paying attention to deck size as well. Temple Warrior definitely goes through their deck a little bit faster than C'Thun Warrior because of cards like Battle Rage. So it could just be Prototype's strategy and, you know, route right now just to take this to fatigue. What now?
It doesn't really look so good for Taft anymore. Okay, well, he does have a Ragnaros, okay. The Ragnaros and the Grom are probably like the last two big minions in his deck. What is his last card? He's only got one card left. Could be a
Corcoran? Yeah, I think we saw one Corcoran so far.
Does he run two, though?
Yeah, not all those that do run two. It looks like here the big guy's gonna come out. C'Thun's gonna come on and wreck this board. Sort of just take advantage of the board. And all of a sudden, a 14-14's on the board. What are you going to do about it?
Now he's probably like, damn. I wish I saved that execute.
Yeah, I think at this point, this is just it, right? I mean, You don't have enough threats. You're going to need Ragnaros to really just hit face.
I think he was just hoping that he didn't have C'Thun yet.
Yeah, even with, I think, you know, Prototype knows Grom's still in there, probably been tracking all the cards, probably knows what's left, and there's just not going to be enough damage for the Tempo Warrior. 35, 25 armor, 10 health. Enjoy your fatigue, right?
That's a lot of armor.
Eden has the ability to sort of actually take out the 6-6 with Blood Ichor and the weapon. So probably, just last sort of fighting chance here. Gonna still make the correct play, get out the minion there. Gonna be able to hit face with Grom as well.
Just hoping he doesn't have any execute.
Yeah, just hoping, really. I mean, Prototype could even, you know, play Brawl and then play execute just for laughs, but it looks like here, just gonna play the execute, and that's going to wrap the series. Prototype is gonna take it with C'Thun Warrior, and it looks like, looking at that series, Taps just could not get a win with the Tempo Warrior right there.
Yeah, it lost like 3 matches, really. It was against the Miracle Rogue and the Reno Lock, and yeah, it lost 3.
Yeah, it lost all 3 games. Yeah. So we saw that deck, like, sometimes it works perfectly, sometimes it has a little bit more rough start, and we just saw, never got a firm grasp of the board. Even that last match started to get bored, but it might have been a little bit too late. And guys, when we return on Tuesday Night Hype, we're going to have our final between Simebaim and its Prototype.